Yeah. So today we have this pedagogical talk on primordial black holes, how its signature in cosmology by Vivian. He is a professor, recently moved University of Montpellier. Before he was a postdoc in Johns Hopkins, and he has done a lot of research on this, on PBH and axions, especially in signature in cosmology. Okay, I think you can start now. Yeah.
Okay, so hi everyone. It's my pleasure to be here with you today. Unfortunately, only remotely would have been such a pleasure to be there in person, but that's better than nothing. And it's a great honor to talk at this amazing conference. I see there is lots of great speakers and looking forward to hear all of the talks. And I'm going to talk about, or I've been asked to talk about more of the observational consequences of various non-standard dark matter candidates. So today is going to be primordial black holes. I'm going to build on what Yassine and Eli have talked about. And I know there will be some overlap with what Yassine has talked about, but I believe pedagogy is also through repetition, and hopefully I can build and maybe present some more advanced topics and alternative things. And then I'll talk tomorrow about action-like particle in cosmology, so the part that David has kind of left out nicely, that is about the impact of action-like particle on the transfer function and the CMB, the Lyman alpha business, and so on. So for today, let me focus on primordial black holes. So the first thing to say, and I think you've understood it quite well now, is that primordial black holes are great dark matter candidates. They have been proposed already a long time ago by Stephen Hawking, Carr, and they have been studied quite a lot now for 40 years. So what we can say, they do not emit light, they are non-relativistic, they are nearly collisionless, they're formed before BBN. So a priori, everything is fine, and they checked a lot of the characteristics that dark matter needs to have. On the plus side, it's been suggested that they might solve some of the so-called small scale issues of dark matter. They have also been suggested that the seeds of the large structures that we see in the galaxies, so the supermassive black holes that exist in nearly all galaxies, to my knowledge, or that we can know of. And of course, because they have been studied so long, the nice thing is that they can be probed in many ways. That's one thing that people have realized. But because they can be probed in many ways, unfortunately, they are also subject to many observational constraints. And today, I'm going to focus on some of the cosmological constraints. So this is a little outlook of my lecture today. I'm briefly going to talk on what I would say are the model-dependent constraints that have to do with the primordial black hole formation, and in particular, the constraints that apply on the primordial power spectrum. I know that Yassine also has talked about this, so I'll go quite fast. The second thing is that I'm going to build over what Yassine has talked about, the fact that then I'm going to move on and talk about the constraints that really apply on the black holes themselves. And I'm going to talk about the problematic of accretion. That's a big problem for primordial black holes, especially in the larger than solar mass black holes scenarios. And I'm going to talk also, I'm going to move from what he discussed as being the spherical accretion scenario and show you what happens in case that a disk can form around a black hole. Then I'll discuss something that is more for the future, although we do have some intriguing signals coming from that era. That's called the 21 centimeter signal. And this is going to be a game changer as far as this business is concerned and looking for primordial black holes. I'll discuss what happens also if dark matter is not made only of black holes, but in mixed models. And I touched upon the idea that, in fact, dark matter could even, or WIMPs could be at risk in the case where primordial black hole exists. And here I also touched upon the connection with supermassive black holes at the center of galaxies. And finally, I'll review, but I've seen that Yassine has talked about this, so I might go quite fast about this, the constraints on evaporating black holes that exist at small mass. And for more details, I'm just giving you some of these recent reviews that have been put out. And you see, it's a very, very active field, because reviews can be published every 6 months, and you see the constraints evolving almost at each time, and as they are reviewed by the community. So the basic picture first that you all have in mind is that primordial black holes can be formed from large initial fluctuations that usually are created from inflation. As the fluctuation enter the horizon again during the radiation era, they are the inhomogeneities might exceed some threshold, and the threshold is something that is of order one. Typically, if you would think about the equation of states to be the typical level of pressure, although it depends on the geometry exactly of the problem, and the mass that is within the horizon at that time is usually of large fraction of the mass is then converted into a black hole. Small scales enter first, so small mass black holes create first. And if fluctuations follow a Gaussian statistic, then there is a simple correlation between the fraction of primordial black holes at formation and the amplitude of fluctuation that is directly related to the threshold above which you can create fluctuation. And typically, if that threshold is of order one, to have a primordial black holes to be formed and in a cosmological population of primordial black holes, you're going to have to have fluctuations of order one. So this is what the typical primordial power spectrum would look like. So we believe that there might be bumps that have been created from, and for this, I'm sure this has been already covered or will be covered. There are many talks that are going to be that is going to cover this part. But typically it comes from specific physics of inflation, either because of some flat inflation point where the inflaton is in what we call ultra slow roll, or thanks to the dynamics of multi-fields and so on that leads to this ultra-slow roll or to some quantum diffusion of the inflaton. And the alternative scenarios, which are also interesting, is even if you don't have such a large bump, a big bump, you could have a threshold that is decreased because of phase transition in the early universe that can occur at the QCD scale, at the MEV, at the electroweak phase transition scales. And this can also lower the threshold for formation. And as you know, this is also a possibility to create black holes. But there are constraints on the amplitude of primordial fluctuations. The best constraint, so this is the amplitude actually of the adiabatic part of the spectrum. And the best constraints are on relatively large scales, come from Planck, are completed nicely by the Lyman alpha observation. So I think it's fair to say that it would be not reasonable to have primordial black holes of such mass or such scales. However, you see that the rest of the scales are fairly unconstrained. There is a limit. If you assume a Gaussian statistic, you can do a one-to-one correlation between the relic density that you would need to be the dark matter and the fluctuation, the amplitude of fluctuation that you need, just from the formula that I showed before. And today, I just wanted to briefly re-mention, because I see that Yacine has talked about it, this constraints from the energy distribution of the CMB. And I'm going to touch upon the Lyman alpha constraint here. So the idea is that when you create large density fluctuation in the early universe, the inhomogeneities inherited by the photons can be dissipated because you have early on a primordial plasma in which you have an acoustic wave that dissipates energy. So the power at small scale is going to be damped via Compton scattering. This is what is basically called the silk damping. It's a very well-known effect in the CMB that manifests also as a suppression of power in the anisotropies. And as the anisotropies are suppressed, it means that the photons thermalize. And depending on when the thermalization happens, you can actually, maybe not all processes that would lead you back to a black body distribution are active. And the most important processes would be Bremsstrahlung, Compton, and double Compton scattering that allows you to both exchange, achieve kinetic equilibrium and chemical equilibrium. And you know that if those processes go out of equilibrium, a spectral distortion can occur. And spectral distortion are usually quantified in terms of the deviation with respect to a black body at a given temperature. And there has been lots of work about characterizing the effect of energy injection on the spectrum, and so in terms of distortion of the spectrum. And there is a formalism with this Green function formalism that is nicely reviewed in this paper, for instance, but there is a large literature. It's hard to really cite everything, but please go in this paper if you want to learn more about this. And this Green function looks like this, depending on the redshift at which you inject your energy. And the basic idea is that at early time, and this looks like, this tells you on the left side, tells you as a function of redshift, what typical process is going to be relevant. So at very early time, your distribution is going to thermalize to a black body. However, the black body might not be of the same temperature, and the superposition of two black bodies is actually not a black body, and the distortion looks like this red here. After a while, the processes of kinetic and ensure kinetic equilibrium are still active, but the processes that ensure chemical equilibrium, so this Dumble Compton scattering, for instance, go out of equilibrium, and you create a chemical potential or something that looks like a chemical potential in the distribution. And if you looked at the difference with respect to a black body, this leads to this blue shape in the Green's function. And finally, the last one that you know is when also kinetic decoupling is not achieved anymore, and then you create a wide distortion that is a boost of energy from the small the photons that have low energy can be boosted to higher energy. So you have a depletion of low energies and a boost at high energies. So these are the typical shape of the black body of the spectral distortion, and the reality is that the superposition of the spectral distortion might be more complicated than just the sum of them, and there are some ways you can trace from the shape, if there were ever a measurement of a spectral distortion, you might be able to trace back the shape of the energy injection. We have constraints on the level of spectral distortion, on the chemical potential or this Y distortion, from actually relatively old, more than 20 years now, by the FIRES satellite. And this allows us to constrain spectral distortions created by the dissipation of this high fluctuation from the acoustic wave. And I know Yacine talked about this, but the typical shape is this exponential suppression, just a damping, like a friction term, in this acoustic wave on scales that are given by the Thomson scattering here, that are given by the mean free pass associated to Thomson scattering. Let me be slightly more precise. And there is a mapping between the scale of this effect and the range of mass that will lead to an effect on the primordial boron spectrum in the black body distribution, or rather. And the huge caveat, and actually in the standard picture, this completely rules out the possibility that you have a significant, and by significant, I mean something greater than at least 10 to the minus 18. This is the fraction of primordial black holes over the total density of dark matter. And even I don't remember the exact number, this is cut, but it's basically ruled out that you have in the standard picture, meaning Gaussian fluctuation, that you have that you can have a significant fraction of primordial black holes with mass above something like 10 to the 5. There is, however, a caveat, that is, you can, as I stress, you can play with the statistic. And you can imagine that if your distribution is, for instance, much more narrow, then it's a large fluctuation might occur much more rarely. And then you can, by playing with this type of the shape of the distribution, or if it's skewed towards lower densities and so on, you can play with that the shape of the distribution to relax the constraints. So this is something to keep in mind, that the constraints applying on primordial black holes from the spectral distortion typically depend on the statistics of your fluctuation. And of course, it's not clear that the Gaussian approximation still apply when you have those scenarios. I believe in some cases it's the case, but in some cases it's definitely not the case, especially if you have multi-field inflation and things like that. The second typical constraint that can occur from cosmology, and that are, I'm going to say, somewhat model independent, although details matter here, but let me forget about details, are the one coming from Lyman alpha. And it's a bit odd, it's a bit orthogonal to what you might be used to, that is Lyman alpha being used to probe power suppression in the primordial power spectrum. But this is an idea that dates back to those guys. And that comes from the fact that, okay, let's assume we have a homogeneously distributed population of black holes. This homogeneously distribution of black holes will lead to a power spectrum enhancement due to simply the fact that you have a Poisson noise. You know, some places you're going to have a black hole, some other you won't. This is typical of a white noise, and that follows. And those fluctuations are simply going to follow the Poisson distribution, with what is the probability that characterizes is simply the probability of finding a black hole in a given volume. And this is encoded by the number density, the comoving number density at formation here. because we assume that everything is randomly distributed, obviously. And so this primordial, this power spectrum now, this is a primordial power spectrum of so-called isocurvature contribution, because it's really a, it's affecting the number density of primordial, it's related to the, to change or to fluctuation in the number density of primordial black holes, that would be the dark matter here. And those can enhance, what happens is that it can enhance the fluctuation on very small scales. This is quite, I think, intuitive. On very small scales, you might find a black hole or not. And while on very large scales, you're going to homogeneize, and on very large scales, you're always going to find a black hole, is what it says. And so typically, what it means is that the is that on small scales, you might see more structures that you would expect in the standard model. And to probe the structures on small scale, a pristine way is to look at fluctuation of the so-called Lyman alpha forest. And so the Lyman alpha forest, I don't know if it's been introduced yet, is the idea that you can look at very distant objects, typically quasars here, that have a, that emit some type of continuum light spectrum that is absorbed along the way by hydrogen clouds when the redshift, the energy of the photon is resonating with the hydrogen level, energy level, Lyman alpha level. And so you can see an absorption forest along the way. And as this absorption forest is going to probe the level of inhomogeneity that you have in between you and the object that emits the light, this is called the Lyman alpha forest, and allows you to probe the level of inhomogeneities. And typically, we have observation of this. So this is what we probe is called the flux power spectrum, is the amount of flux that is transmitted. So it's the amount of light that is transmitted by the from the quasar. And it's complicated. I don't want to pretend that I'm going to explain the details of the Lyman alpha forest here. But what you want to know is that these typical fluctuations are going to lead to an over-prediction for the amplitude of this fluctuation and allow you to put a strong constraint or a fairly model-independent constraints on the level of primordial black holes that you have. And for a 100% primordial black holes, their mass cannot be greater than 60 solar mass. This is what you form the Lyman alpha. So that's nice because this is also a model-independent type of constraint. Now I'm going to talk about, I'm going to move on, and I'm going to talk about really constraints that don't apply from the on the primordial power spectrum, so to say, but I'm going to talk about really the impact of the black holes on the surrounding mediums. And I'm going to, so this is a nice review, by the way, a nice recent review that highlights the various constraints that exist in the on the primordial black holes. And I'm sure you've seen that already, there will be talk about this, but at low mass, typically what we have are the typical constraints from evaporation. Then you have the mass coming in, you have the constraints coming from the lensing. Then you have the constraints coming from gravitational waves. And you have dynamical constraints from the stabilities of objects that we see, so-called white binaries or dwarf galaxies. And finally, you have accretion constraints coming from the impact of a black hole on its surrounding medium that can, if it's heavy enough, accrete matter heated to high energies, to high temperature, that will then emit a radiation that can then again either see or can impact the intergalactic medium. And I'm going to talk about accretion and evaporation with the CMB and the 21 centimeter signal today. So the, as I already mentioned, the big question here is how do an electromagnetic, this is actually more generic than just the case of primordial black holes. That is, what's going to happen is we're going to have a process here that is going to be sourced by primordial black holes that's going to inject energy in the form in an electromagnetic form. And the question is, how does the CMB react? So we said already that it can generate spectral distortion. And typically, the level of spectral distortion with respect to a black body distribution has been constrained to be to the level of 10 to the minus 5, 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 5. And typically, for primordial black holes, those constraints, except the one that I mentioned before that are model dependent, if you look at the electromagnetic energy injection from the primordial black holes, typically they are not really relevant to the business for the reason that the energy density in photons is so huge that you would need to, in order to get these large fluctuations, you would need too much of whatever the energy process is responsible for the injection, so accretion or evaporation in that case. So it's been in the first paper were actually estimating that the level of spectral distortion created by, for instance, primordial black hole accretion, it was extremely strong. It turns out that there was some mistake in the calculation, and those in Yassine and Mark Kamenkowski have shown that, in fact, the level of spectral distortion from primordial black hole is relatively weak. And I believe this argument also applies for spectral distortions coming from evaporation, although I'm not sure whether a detailed calculation has been made. The second possibility is that they can affect the, instead of affecting the photons, they might affect the baryons, which are strongly coupled through Compton scattering, tightly coupled with the baryons, with the photons. And typically what they can affect is this era called recombination, and that you have heard again about. So this is an era where the electrons and the protons recombine, where it's the first time the photons are allowed to free stream. And the photon of the CMBS allowed to free stream. And typically, it's considered to be the typical at a redshift of around 1,000. And it's called the last scattering surface, from which we can observe small anisotropies, both in temperature and in polarization, that are simply the imprints of the acoustic fluctuation of this acoustic wave happening in the primordial universe. And if you play with the recombination era, you're going to affect these times. So the main impact of an electromagnetic energy injection is to modify the recombination era. And the way in which it modifies the recombination era is the following. So first, the recombination era is simply, the way you quantify the recombination era is by computing the fraction of free electron in the early universe, which is competition between two terms, a recombination rate between proton and electron going to hydrogen, and an ionization rate due to photoionization by photon. So there is a fantastic discovery by those guys here, including Peebles, that they understood that the main channel for recombination is actually not recombination to the ground state directly, because recombination to the ground state is associated with the emission of a high energy photon or energetic enough to reionize the medium. In fact, it has to go through excited states, such that the photons are not energetic enough to re-anionize the medium. And in fact, it's even the forbidden channel that is the one that is leading the recombination of the universe. This has, of course, has allowed for much higher precision calculation. And right now, the level of precision that we need, and I'm sure Yassine has talked about his fantastic numerical code that allows in milliseconds to get results about at the sub-percent precision on the recombination history that are required in order to get very high level, the very high precision CMB power spectrum. So the reionization history looks like this. Recombination happened at around 1,000 or 1,100. There is a relic fraction of free electron that's important because the photon will potentially will experience some level of scattering. This is called the optical depth. And eventually, something that is not yet known, but there is a process called reionization, which is coming from, we believe, the first stars. And in fact, we hope that by detecting the first stars, we're going to learn about this process and about reionization. And this is where 21 centimeter is going to be a key observables, because it's going to be extremely sensitive to this era. And the idea now is that electromagnetic energy injection are going to affect this either by ionizing the medium more or by heating the medium. And the level of ionization and heating is related to the energy that the plasma can absorb. And the idea, the big complication, in fact, is that the energy that is absorbed by the plasma is not necessarily the same as the energy that is injected by the plasma. And the relation between what you inject and what is deposited is typically encoded by a set of functions. People have run Monte Carlo simulation in order to know how the plasma made of, or in fact the gas after recombination, will react to the energy injection. And typically it encodes both what fraction of the energy is left to interact with the intergalactic medium. So imagine that you have a phenomenon of accretion. Part of the energy is just going to be going away, and potentially you can see it, and the rest of the energy might interact with the intergalactic medium, affecting its properties. And when it interacts with the intergalactic medium, it can either heat the medium ionize the medium or lead to excitation in the energy level of the hydrogen atoms. And yeah, to copy a bit the nomenclature, what people do is usually they split it up so that this function encodes really the plasma properties, and you can compute them independently of the processes. So you can use what has been done for dark matter, for instance, annihilation, to study primordial black holes, while the other term will really encode the energy injection coming from your model. And to stress that again, the idea is that at very early time, before recombination, we are in a hot, dense plasma, all the energy is absorbed. And as the universe recombines and it becomes less and less dense under the influence of the expansion, the universe becomes less and less good a calorimeter. And at some point, instead of studying the impact on the IGM, what you want to do is just look at the light coming out of the process. And if you're interested in learning about this, I recommend those references. So now, I'm going to talk about this before maybe taking questions, unless there are important questions coming out right now. Can I make a quick break just to know?
Can go ahead, and not yet. Yeah.
I believe those are also things that have been discussed by Yassine. So now the problem of primordial black hole is, the question is, what is this energy injection term coming from primordial black hole? So in the past, people have mostly studied the spherical symmetric scenario, where typically what you have is that the black hole accretes matter, leading to this hot, dense plasma of electrons that themselves are going to then emit synchrotron or Bremsstrahlung emission. And the outgoing radiation is then going to maybe re-impact the matter right around the black holes, or go away and affect the intergalactic medium, or if nothing, maybe be visible. People are also looking for this type of effects in our galaxy, obviously. So the problematic of accretion is really old. I mean, you have the first time was studied for a star in an infinite gas cloud, but the shape, the equations are actually the same when you study. It's basically a point-like object. And there's a famous result by Bondi that just tells you that basically the accretion rate is a geometric process, is a geometric result, if you want, where basically you have some type of accreting sphere of reduced giving by this relation, where the 4 pi r squared would give you the sphere that travels at a velocity v through a medium of density rho. Here, the rho at infinity means the density far away from the Bondi radius, in fact. And so this is really just the geometric result. And if you plug what the Bondi radius is, you find this famous relation. And people have then used this relation, but rescaled by a factor lambda to account the fact that the medium is not only sensitive to gravity, but they are also typically pressure from the radiation. Maybe there is Compton drag, for instance, from the CMB photons in the cosmological context, that can affect the efficiency of the accretion. The difficulty in this is to estimate what is the effective velocity here, this velocity that enters the problem. There is no exact calculation. We're talking of small scales. The medium can become non-linear, so you might need to do n-body simulations. And the typical proxy is to say, so originally the speed that was here was actually the sound speed of the medium. And there has been a trick to say that maybe we can replace the sound speed of the medium by the quadratic sum, the quadratic mean between the sound speed of the medium and the relative velocity between the point source object, or the point-like object, sorry, the primordial black holes, and its surrounding medium. It turns out that this is very important in the cosmological context, because this term, the relative velocities, dominates over the sound speed. So primordial black holes in the early universe would travel at supersonic speed. Okay, so, and then the hard question is to, the second part of the hard question, once you know the accretion rate, is to know what is the luminosity of that is emitted. And typically, people relate the luminosity to the accretion rate through what's called the efficiency at converting the gravitational energy into luminosity. And I'm sure that Yassine also talked about these things, but the typical what you want to do is know the temperature close the, where the medium is the hottest, that is very close to the Schwarzschild radius. And there are in the literature about this for spherical accretion, where typically the efficiency scales with the accretion rate and is something like a thousandth of the accretion rate. And then the spectrum is typical of Bremsstrahlung emission. And then you can also apply this formalism. So now I'm going to argue in a second that this actually, it might not be the right picture for the cosmological context, although this is still an open question. And in fact, this formalism can also be applied to the case where the accretion is not spherical. When the gravitational energy is radiated away, what can happen is, and the momentum, angular momentum is conserved, a disk can form. And you might, it's been in the literature, it's been shown that you can actually apply this formulae quite well by just to the case of disk accretion by rescaling with appropriate accretion eigenvalue or efficiency. So these are the two parameters that are going to control typically the physics of accretion at the phenomenological level that we need. The scaling with the mass between the accretion, the efficiency and the scale and the accretion rate might not always be the scaling between the accretion rate and the epsilon and the accretion rate and the efficiency at converting might not always be just a linear law. There might be powers, but let's forget about this for the phenomenological level. So it turns out that CMB constraints strongly depend on the geometry of the accretion. So that's still an open question, I would say, whether in the cosmological context, we should study a spherical, we should assume that the accretion is spherical or disk. But what I want to argue here is that there are reasons to believe it can be a disk-like accretion. And I want also to argue that if that's the case, the constraints are much stronger than what happens in the case of a spherical accretion. So the key question is, does the gas, as it falls and lose gravitational energy, does it have an angular momentum? If it has angular momentum is going to be conserved and is going to form a disk rather than fall straight onto the black hole. And then you need to find a way to lose your angular momentum, typically through friction, in order to have the matter to really fall within the black hole. So an accretion disk form, again, if the gravitational energy is dissipated, but the angular momentum is conserved. So what is the angular momentum associated to a disk? Well, it's simply the Keplerian angular momentum. And if you ask, what is the radius, what is the size of the disk, it's going to be given simply by the Keplerian velocity times the radius of the disk. The angular momentum at a distance, that is the radius of the disk, is given by this relation. And so the question is to estimate, is the angular momentum of the order of this disk of the Keplerian motion? If that's the case, then it means a disk would form. So the angular momentum, by the way, here we're talking of specific angular momentum. It's always the angular momentum divided by the mass. And the angular momentum here, the specific angular momentum is going to have two parts. It's going to have a part that is related to the density gradient perpendicular to the motion of the black hole. And it's going to be a second part that is related to the typical velocity dispersion, the thing that you might have more in mind, that is the typical velocity dispersion on small scales that apply for those black holes. And the first thing to realize is that, so you can ask yourself, you know, what is the, so the we would assume the angular momentum is high enough to form a disk if the radius of the disk is outside the Schwarzschild radius. That's the, let's say, a phenomenological criterion to say that the disk is large enough to be seen. It's just that this size, the angular momentum acquired, is such that its size is larger than the Schwarzschild radius. And if you just ask this type of condition, you obtain this condition, and where you find that if there are density fluctuations that are greater than 10 to the minus 4 on very small scales, here we're talking about the typical scale, the boundary radius scale, so parsec maybe, or something like this, on very small scales, that are greater than 10 to the minus 4, you might have an angular momentum that's large enough to create a disk. Similarly, for this part, you find that the typical velocity needs to follow this law. The fluctuation of the velocity needs to follow this law. And if you're curious about how this comes out, just look at these papers. So the question now is that verified? Well, this is the part where it's harder to say, but what we can say, and as I argued, is that there is an enhanced power spectrum at small scales due to this Poisson fluctuation. So it's likely that indeed the fluctuations are much greater than 10 to the minus 4 at early time. This is really the same origin where the 21 centimeter, the Lyman alpha bonds come about. And the second is that the velocity on the very small scales is hard to compute because, again, it's a nonlinear problem. But we can compute the typical velocity for, let's assume that black holes form binaries, those primordial black holes form binaries, which is true if they are a large fraction of the dark matter. And what you obtain, to cut it short, is that the typical you're going to have that the velocity fluctuation is large enough if the mass follow this law. So at a redshift of order, I put 730 because this is the typical scale, the typical redshift probed by the CMB in terms of energy injection. And so what you find is that for masses greater than at a redshift of 730 and above, black holes that are greater than the solar mass would form a disk according to this simple criterion. And now the question is, so basically we have hints that it's the spherical picture is unstable. This is also something that is supported by numerical simulations. So those numerical simulations been done by in these papers, where here it shows basically the density field. So what they do is they take a black hole and they make it move at supersonic speed, and they look at the geometry and the accretion rate and so on. And what you see is that as the velocity of the black hole increase, the geometry around the black holes move far away from being spherical. In fact, they have also prescription for how the accretion rate scales. It's not clear that the accretion rate still scales like the simple 1 over V cube law that Bondi old found. But let me not talk about this. This is really a complicated topic. But just to say that there are hints that the spherical accretion is probably not the good picture. And the problem now is what type of disk would form over the time scale that we're talking about. We don't know. There is two possibilities. Either you're optimistic or either you're aggressive and you say you're going to take a scenario where the disk that form is going to be extremely efficient at radiating energy. This is the so-called thin disk in which the radiative efficiency is high. These are maybe the most historical disks that are known in the literature. But those would lead to the strongest constraint that is not what people have considered. Usually what people consider are rather the conservative prescriptions for this. And here it depends. So the disks, the physics of disk is a complicated topic again, and I'm far from being an expert, but basically it depends on energetic, on whether the disk is hot, on whether how the momentum is lost, the angular momentum is lost, on how the mass, the matter goes from the disk to the black hole. So all of that is a complicated topic, and I'm sure that there is not a unique picture of what should happen in a cosmological context. But it's possible to take a conservative prescription, so a disk that has a relatively low radiative efficiency. Those are called advection-dominated accretion flow for the technical terms. Those are interesting, those terms, because those disks have been observed or can explain the observation, for instance, of Sagittarius A star. And just to show you practically what happens is here, the accretion rate on the left and on the right, the luminosity, compared between a disk which I consider conservative and a spherical accretion scenario. And what you see is that the accretion rate in the spherical accretion scenario is much higher. So this accretion eigenvalue is close to one in the case of a spherical accretion. But in the case of a disk, of course, the key idea is that angular momentum is conserved, so it's harder to accrete matter. And so the accretion rate is reduced. But because it's reduced, but at the same time that it's reduced, the temperature that can be reached are much higher. It's a much hotter disk. And because it's a hot disk, it can emit more energy. And so the efficiency at converting the gravitational energy into radiation is actually higher than in the spherical accretion. This is the spherical accretion. And these are the typical luminosity associated to disk. So this is the typical idea, is that in a disk-like accretion, you're going to have a lower accretion rate just from the physical properties, but a higher temperature, so a higher emission efficiency at converting your radiation to radiation, the gravitational energy. Without entering again into the detail, what is the shape of this energy injection? Typically, it's dominated by synchrotron and bremsstrahlung. So it has this power law shaped with a cutoff due to the fact that the electrons at some point don't have given by the temperature of the electron. And this converts into a typical, what I mentioned, this energy deposition function that is going to have a different shape depending on whether your accretion is spherical or disk-like. And this again means that because this energy deposition is going to have a different shape depending on the shape of the accretion, it means that the impact on the ionization fraction is going to change depending on the typical on the geometry of the accretion. But it leads to a similar effect, that is, it delays the recombination and it changes the level of the plateau that is left of free electron. And in terms of what it does on the CMB, it looks like this. The recombination delay typically means that you shift the peak and you allow more time for this diffusion damping effect that we mentioned, the seek damping to happen. And this is what leads to this small oscillation and this exponential line cutoff. The second part is this higher phase-out plateau. And this higher freeze-out plateau leads to this huge reionization bump. This is the characteristic of reionization is to lead to an increase of polarization. And here I'm looking at E-mode polarization, but you know also that reionization is going to lead to B-mode polarization if there is a primordial gravitational wave, and this is one of the targets. But here we're looking at E-mode fluctuation. And so the effect of electromagnetic energy injection, that is to mimic early reionization, is going to create a big bump in the polarization. And so it means that if you had accurate measurement of the E-mode polarization, you could get stronger constraints on primordial black holes. The problem being that at some point, you're going to be limited by cosmic variance on the scale. And I'm going to end here for the first part and take questions. But the constraints would look like this. This is back in with Planck 2015 data. They have improved a bit. I'm going to show in a second with Planck 2018. But basically, the spherical accretion, that is by surely a conservative scenario, but I believe there are reasons to believe that this geometry does not apply to the problem at hand, would lead to excluding black holes of above 100 solar mass, while the disk accretion would lead to exclude black hole above, depending on what you take as a proxy for the relative for this effective velocity that enter the accretion rate between a few solar mass and even subsolar mass. So keep in mind that there is two main uncertainties. There is the geometry and the relative uncertainty. And in the worst case scenario, it can kill a very large range of primordial black hole mass. While in the most conservative scenario, primordial black holes of the order of 30 solar mass, which are the one that kind of excited the business from the discovery of advanced LIGO, would still be allowed. And so I believe that there are reasons to believe accretion is happening in the disk-like form, but this really needs to be studied with higher numerical tools and body simulation, including hydrodynamical simulation and so on. So I'm going to stop here and take questions if there are.
Okay, so one.
So Subhina, hello, Subhina, can you hear me now or no?
Yeah, you can read out the questions. Yeah.
Okay. But in the chat box, yeah, there is one question from Sandipan. For PBH dark matter, how crucial is the fact that a PBH has a curvature singularity inside? Could we explore a similar physics with some other geodesically incomplete configuration in GR, which has no curvature singularity? If yes, examples, some other novel topological defects in bracket.
Right, so this is a good question. This is really not something I've thought about. What I can say is that those constraints do ignore completely the whatever is inside the black. In fact, what we are really assuming here is simply that those objects are point-like in terms of the scales we are studying. as compared to the scales we are studying. So this is something that I couldn't really say. The fact as the curvature, could we explore? If you had any ideas, we could discuss. But as far as this is concerned, and as far as the typical constraints on primordial black holes are concerned, we kind of forget about the fact, or put under the carpet, the fact that the objects that we are considering have singularities and are not necessarily well understood. But because we are really looking at the big scale picture, and it's for us, those are point-like objects.
Okay, so far there is, Sandipan, you heard the answer. There is one more question came in. So with CMB and reionization bound, can we get 100% dark matter SPBH? Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. This is just what is shown here. I mean, if you had lower mass black holes, in principle, you could. There is the lower than, I would say, let's say a conservative disk accretion, which would be my attitude, would tell you that something below a solar mass is allowed, well, from the point of view of reionization. There is the other hand, that is the reionization, the evaporation, that tells you it's 10 to minus 20, I think, in terms of solar mass. Mm-hmm. So it's something between 10 to the minus 20 and 1 is allowed from the point of view of the CMB.
Next question is from Anupama, which says that, what is this question from YouTube? Fuzzy Hobo, what is disk accretion? Does it have to do with a halo around a black hole?
Yes, exactly. This is exactly what we are talking about. And I'm sorry if I wasn't clear, but we're talking about the halo around the black hole, that depending on whether or not angular momentum is present and is conserved, is going to be leading to either a spherical accretion, or if angular momentum is here, is high and conserved, a disk accretion. That's what we're talking about.
So the next question is from Suhani Gupta. Can the standard formalism of bias also used to study the relation between Lyman alpha flux power spectrum and primordial primordial black holes?
Yeah, I guess so, in the sense that I'm guessing I'm not an expert on the bias formalism and so on, but the standard formalism of bias, well, I'm not completely sure what you mean by the bias here. If you mean the bias of between, for instance, measuring the galaxy power spectrum and measuring the matter power spectrum, those are completely different observables. So this is not the same thing. So actually, I'm not completely sure what is meant here. If it's meant about the formation of black holes, yeah, I mean, the understanding the picture going from a large fluctuation enters and we have a primordial black hole's power spectrum, that's on the power spectrum associated to primordial black holes. This connection, here we're assuming Gaussian fluctuation and so on, and whether they cluster and so on, those are big questions that are still on the market.
I see. The next one is from Debu. If one considers black hole remnants because of quantum effect, will there be any effect on the PBH constraints?
Black hole remnants
because of quantum effect. Oh, I see. Will there be any effect on the PBH constraints?
If you mean, I'm not exactly sure what is meant here.
Yeah,
I mean, they are. No, I don't really understand the question. I apologize.
This is from Subinoy. Can gravity wave probe that low mass PBH, which can be 100% dark matter?
Absolutely. Yeah. Gravity waves are going to be a key constraint, and I believe that's the next topic for Yassine. I think I had a figure. I don't know if I do. But if you look here, the constraints from gravity waves can come in and constrain. And this is probably already all because of the nanograph stuff. And so,
As I don't see any other question, I have a small question. The dark matter halo around Milky Way, say, that also can be constructed with primordial black holes. I mean, this is from, I am Debashish Majumdar from Saha Institute of Nuclear Physics.
The dark matter, yes, there is. I'm not completely sure. So are you saying? From the point of view of gravity, whether the gravitational potential is created by primordial black holes or particles, that's not the same. Then there is another question, that is, if you have subfraction of primordial black holes, what is the impact of fraction of primordial black holes. And you have also another component of dark matter. What is the impact of this fraction of subfraction of primordial black holes onto this other component of dark matter? And what type of halos are formed around the primordial black holes?
I'm
probably not going to have the time, but very briefly.
I understand. But there is one more question. One or two questions came in. Shantanu is asking, related to Sandipan's question, I have to read the Sandipan's question once again, but related to Sandipan's question, can we have cosmic strings as dark matter? What is Sandipan's question? Sandipan's question
it was related to the singularity of... dark matter, I believe, are really well studied. The problem, I'm not an expert. As a theoretical question, yes, we can have cosmic strings dark matter. This is a well-motivated model. As an observational question, the problem is the spectrum of fluctuation that are generated, the spectrum of structure that is going to be formed are not the adiabatic one that we see. That's my understanding of the. But I'm sure that experts would have a different opinion on that.
Yeah, he also says that whether it would play almost the same role as primordial black holes or not, these cosmic strings. Yeah, so you gave the answer. Okay. So, Suvinay, I don't find any other questions, so we can go to the next presentation. Yeah.
Okay.
So, thanks, Vivian. Yeah.
No problem. So, thanks, I have 10 minutes left. I'm sorry, but you'll have the slide if you're interested in more things. So, I'm going to talk about 21 centimeter now, because this is really something new and futuristic and very interesting. That is, as I mentioned already, primordial black hole accretion lead to the increase of this ionization fraction and the temperature of the intergalactic medium at late times. And unfortunately, from the point of view of the CMB, it is losing sensitivity because of the fact that most of its sensitivity comes from the time of recombination. So since we affect most of the effect are on late times, is there a better probe of late times? And the answer is yes. And this is 21 centimeters. So let me talk quickly about 21 centimeters. So 21 centimeters is simply the emission associated to the spin flip of the hydrogen atom, the neutral hydrogen atom. It's quantified by the spin temperature, which simply helps you to quantify the number of states that are in the excited state as opposed to the ground states. And assuming that you are at equilibrium, the excitation process and the desexcitation process are at equilibrium, you can relate the spin temperature to the various processes that are actually leading to the excitation and that are interaction with CMB photons. So CMB photons come and can lead to this excitation and then the desexcitation. Then there are also the second process that can excite this are collision within the gas, kinetic interaction of hydrogen atoms or hydrogen and electrons and so on. And finally, the last part that can excite this transition is the so-called the Lyman alpha photons created by stars. And this is a little bit of a complicated picture, but the idea is Lyman alpha would come, excite the Lyman alpha transition, but the electron de-excite, he ends up with a different level of the hyperfine structure. And so these are the three processes that are believed to dominate or lead to the emission of 21 centimeters. And what people are going to measure in principle, you can go on, take a telescope and look for the intensity of that signal. In principle, that's not exactly what the people are going to look for. What people are going to look for is differences between, assuming that you have a clear view of the 21 centimeter of the CMB. So basically you look at the 21 centimeter line, but in the CMB spectrum. So you should see the CMB as a sum, as a contribution at this number of photons in this energy range. And then they're going to see the difference between this and between hydrogen clouds. So when there is an hydrogen cloud, part of the CMB photons are going to be absorbed or there's going to be a little bit more because of these collisions and things like this. So you're going to see the difference between clear views that are believed to be just the CMB or any foreground in reality and and these hydrogen clouds. And the 21 centimeter is theoretically easy to understand from redshift 1000 to 30, typically when there is no stars, when there is only the interaction of hydrogen atoms and the CMB, this is well understood. And then there is a huge astrophysical uncertainty. Basically, once we start to say let's switch on the stars, because we don't understand really much yet how reionization has happened. I mean, I'm of course a bit mean because I don't really know the topic. I'm sure that experts will tell you, oh, we have a clear picture, but there is uncertainties. And this is what are the typical prediction for what this differential brightness temperature, it's called the differential brightness temperature, but think of it as simply a differential in intensity with respect to a background that would be the CMB photons. And what is believed to happen is that the first thing we should see is that the Lyman alpha photons are going to excite this transition. And they are going to, and for reason that I don't have time to explain, the Lyman alpha temperature is believed to be equal to that of the gas. And the gas at late time is colder than the photon. And so it leads to this absorption of the 21 centimeter. Then as the first star starts to collapse and form and have supernovae or form binaries and emit X-ray and so on, and there's a more complex dynamics, we believe that is going to hit the gas, and eventually that is going to eventually overshoot potentially the balance and lead to a signal emitted in emission. And when the universe starts to be reionized, the number of hydrogen atoms that are in the neutral state goes to zero, and the 21 centimeter intensity goes to zero. And so this is what is believed to happen. And it turns out that this signal has tentatively been measured in the last, when was it, 3 years or something like this, 2 or 3 years, by the so-called EDGES experiment that has measured something that is completely unexpected, or almost completely unexpected. They measured this. T21 is the differential brightness temperature, it's the same name. They measure a huge absorption trough here that is much, much, much lower than the astrophysical prediction. Basically, the astrophysical prediction were predicting that the lowest you can be is if the spin temperature is completely dictated by the gas temperature, and the gas temperature being colder than the photon temperature. And since we know in the lambda CDM model how we can predict how cold the gas must be, we could predict how small the differential brightness temperature can be, how large the absorption trough can be. And we observe something that is 2 to 3 times larger than that. It's still tentative, not clear at all that this is a primordial signal, but these are very, very important implications for any constraints on electromagnetic energy injection, and in particular primordial black holes, because if you have one thing to understand is when you inject energy, you reheat the medium. You do exactly the opposite than what you need to do, that is to cool the medium. So what can happen typically is that you can use this EDGES measurement to put extremely stringent constraints on the existence of primordial black holes. If you assume even just a 5 sigma difference between the measurement, usually constraints are quoted at the 2 sigma level, but remember that here we are already in tension. So if you assume that if you spoil the model even more, and for different, these are different typical accretion scenario. You see the Planck bounds are here, and you can completely overshoot the Planck bounds. In reality, there is a little bit more that you can learn from 21 centimeter, and I think I will stop with that. I'm sorry, and if you have questions, I'll take them. But there is a little bit more because you don't only observe the global signal, you don't just observe the integrated intensity of the 21 centimeter, but you can also see structures. You can use the 21 centimeter to look at the evolution of structures. And what happens is that the primordial black holes are going to affect the homogeneities in the 21 centimeter signal. So the 21 centimeter, so these are, think of it as power spectrum of a given mode. It's a given mode, 2 different modes as a function of redshift. So large scales, small scales, and we look at how it evolves as a function of redshift. And this gray would look like what potential experiments that are being built right now could measure above, you know, with respect to some fiducial model that has been chosen, and that doesn't matter for us. The main thing that you need to remember is that primordial black holes have this long penetrating, the emission associated to primordial black holes can penetrate the IGM and homogeneize. Basically, what it's going to do is that it's going to homogeneize the IGM temperature. And so it's going to suppress the level of inhomogeneities. And so typically, we expect that this can also lead, if we don't detect them, either to a huge global, it means that we have a large discovery potential, or to strong bounds on the fraction of primordial black holes. And this is really something that is going to come and become extremely, extremely important also for any type of electromagnetic energy injection, probably in the next 5 to 10 years, something like this. So I'm sorry, I realized that I was a little bit ambitious about what I could cover. And if you have questions, I could cover, I could talk about the connection to supermassive black holes. Otherwise, you'll have the slides, obviously. I'm just going to jump to my conclusions. Yes, one thing that I do want to stress is that all of these tools that allow you to compute the impact on the CMB, on the large scale, on the temperature of the IGM, and so on, are actually public. So you can go ahead and play. And if you wanted to do some exercises, and if you needed to familiarize more yourself with this concept, please go ahead, look at this paper for all the details about this code. It's a package or a branch of the very famous cosmological class. And it's, in principle, it's supposed to be relatively easy to use if we did a good job. And you can also study the effect of other typical models, such as dark WIMP annihilation and so on. So my apology for taking a little too long and being too ambitious, but let me just summarize. So the cosmological probes are extremely powerful at probing electromagnetic signatures of primordial black holes. Accretion, I believe we can say, exclude 100% of dark matter for masses above, as primordial black holes, if their mass is above 30 solar mass in the spherical case, and typically one solar mass in the disk case. This shows you the typical uncertainty on the geometry. Evaporation excludes 100% of dark matter for black holes below 10 to the 17 grams, 10 to the minus 20 solar mass. I think that's, I might be wrong in the 10 to the minus 20, but whatever, 10 to the 17 gram. 21 centimeter is going to be a game changer as far as looking for primordial black holes, or even, even sub-fraction, very small fraction of primordial black holes. And the thing that I did not have time to talk about is to say that even if we detect primordial black holes, a fraction of primordial black holes, this is still very, very interesting. First, to understand maybe what are the supermassive black holes at the heart of the center of our galaxies, and also maybe as a silver bullet for the existence of WIMPs. And this is really interesting just because of the fact that WIMPs around the black holes will form a very steep density profile, and very lead, if they annihilate, can lead to very high luminosity that we don't see, and so we can constrain. And of course, there are also constraints on the formation model itself. And I believe that you will learn about gravitational wave bounds in tomorrow. Oops. Sorry, I'm going to stop here. Thank you.
So hello, Vivian. There are a few more questions. Are you going to take it now?
We can have one or two maximum. One because we are running late. But okay. A lot of questions coming. We'll email Vivian later all the questions.
Okay.
Tomorrow you can answer. Yeah.
So there is one from Raghu earlier. If black hole form part of the dark matter and there is another homogeneous component, is there a time scale over which the black holes will absorb the rest of the dark matter?
The typical time scale is actually the same, is the accretion time scale, which actually in this case could be the, so if there is a, so yes, the time scale is order, if you, I think I have it here, it's order 400 million years. If you look at the, it turns out if you take the accretion rate and you ask what is the time scale for the mass to grow of order one, that is something that you can answer easily. And the typical time scale is called the Salpeter time scale for accretion, is of order 400 million years. So if you have a large fraction of primordial black holes and a large fraction of something else that makes up the dark matter, it means that in principle, you could imagine that these guys are going to accrete those guys and increase their mass. And as they increase their mass, they deplete the other fraction. The most likely scenario is that you might have a small fraction of primordial black holes, in which case the impact on the other guys is going to be very local. They can increase their mass, but does not necessarily affect the overall energy density of the dark matter.
Okay, just one last question, I think, Suvinoy, that will be. So this is from Shukunna. Why do PBHs move at supersonic speed?
Yes, so the real thing is, I mean, of course, it's a relative velocity. And the reality that you have to understand is that baryons are coupled to photons. And this is the acoustic wave is the origin for the velocity. So it's really, this is because of the interaction of baryons with photons that acquired this this very, very large velocity, that the relative velocity can be said to be supersonic.
Okay, so thank you, Vivian. I mean, as Subinoy said, that we are running out of time. So I think we'll go to the next talk.